honest to his love thought, manifest in the divine flesh, Jesus coming again, our beloved prophet, Noble Ju Ali, the first American-born prophet in this era and time. And often enough, we are asked, is he a prophet of Allah? If you gotta ask, then obviously you don't know. And one thing, no one had to prove to me that he was a prophet or convince me. I opened my heart and listened, and thus my spirit embraced the whole idea behind Prophet Noble Ju Ali. Imagine coming into the temple not really understanding who he was, his birth date, what he liked, not even knowing the real history of the MSTA. I didn't go through years of preparation of information about the prophet. I was just told that, sister, did you know we had a prophet that looked just like us, that came for us, that was not made up to where we can have to recolor him in to make him appear to us? He came during a time when our people needed him. That alone, that little bit, that little mustard seed of information was planted within my heart. And thus, with my own patience and wanting to learn more, I sought an understanding. And I embraced that. And I give praises to my Father God Allah every Friday, because it's a way that where we can gather together, we can, I always say it's a group spiritual therapy, but it's a way that we can be the voice for those who are voiceless, not able to articulate the degree and application of this. Perhaps they knew, perhaps they are still feel of being held to past sins, a slave to their sins, or a slave to somebody else's idea. In more scientific America, we champion for those who are unable to champion for themselves. The prophet said, in the more scientific America, we are to uplift fallen humanity. But in order for even myself to help uplift those who are needing it, I had to uplift myself. And that's a continuation, and every day is uplifting myself in my words, acts, and deeds to manifest the true nature of what it is to be in this way. Islam has been marginalized as a pastime, an extracurriculum activity, some foreign idea, some outside concept. It's been reduced to nothing. It's been reduced to, in college they have courses where it's not one of the major courses.
Elective.
Well, you have to take an elective. It doesn't matter, you can pick whatever you want, doesn't, you know, you just need to get that little 1 or 2 credits to pass. You know, it's not considered, you know, it can be in little meaning, pottery or whatever. It's not important. So they made Islam an elective. It's not important. They downgraded it to an elective, to a side note, to a condiment, to a ketchup packet used up under the car seat. That's how Islam has been marginalized. But I give praises to my Father God Allah that there are Moorish American Muslims or Muslims that's living in the faith of Islam that embrace this day and coming together where we can raise our hearts, our minds, our voices to speak reason and rationale to those who are open hearts and wanting to receive it. Islam is not meant to be forced on anyone that doesn't want to reveal it. Don't you dare throw these precious teachings to someone who doesn't want them. Don't you dare cast these divine teachings to those who are closed to the idea of embracing this way of life. There's a lot of folks that are spiritually hungry. We save it for them. So we give not only praises to our Father God, a lot of that. Even in the midst of our adversity, even in the midst of the calamities, the trials and tribulations, we give praises to our Father God a lot. For it says in our chapter 1 that we will go through trials and tribulations manifold. It's already been destined. But it's not what we go through, it's how we go through it that's going to determine our faith, if we are holding to our faith. So we give praises to our Father God a lot for giving us His love thought manifested in divine flesh. Let me ring my bell. Manifested in divine flesh, our beloved prophet, Nobuju Ali, the first American born prophet in this era and time.
The only
American born prophet in this era and time. I love my prophet. I honor my prophet. My prophet said, defend him to the utmost of our very life. And too often, folks tend to utter and repeat and verbiate a lot of what is written about our prophet, but it's not mastered on their heart. It's a nice side note, something to say. But folks will fight to the death, I mean going toenail to toenail about nonsense. But when it comes to the prophet, when it comes to protecting the integrity of our prophet, when people talk about our prophet, when they marginalize our prophet, folks rather take a back seat. I don't want the confrontation. I don't want confrontation. Something Martin Luther King said, it's not the loud voices of our enemies we shall remember. It's the silence of our friends. Too many folks are silent about this. And your passive nature is giving a pass to evil. It's like a bill. Because you don't talk about it, you don't want to pay it, you ignore it, it don't go away. And by all in measures, they basically accepting the fact that you realize you got a bill, but you are not obligated or you not have taken the responsibility to pay it. So the passiveness of you turning a side note to when the prophet is belittled, when his teachings are misused, and you take a side note to take a seat and not speak and be silent, then you are no different than the enemy. You just basically stepped away from the door. As you know, we said we're supposed to keep the unbelievers out. You just sat down and let them in. Y'all going in, ain't no sense of being. I tried, hell, I can't do this by myself. They make up all kinds of excuses. Because we don't want to offend our friends. We don't want to offend those who we want to be our friends. We don't want to look like the bad guy. You know how many prophets, how all the prophets of Allah always was revealed as the bad guy? How are we placing ourselves not wanting to look like the bad guy? We don't want to be confrontational. But if you are in this and you live in this truth, it's always going to be confrontation, even with yourself. How do you sleep at night? Can you sleep at night? We give praises to our Father God, honors to our prophet, honors to Mark Messiah Garvey. He too was under a lot of confrontation within his own ranks, betrayed by someone he entrusted. Mark Messiah Garvey, not enough is spoken about him, but we understand that he too was divinely prepared in due time, that he too was divinely prepared by our great Father God Allah, that he is the prophet's forerunner. Why? Because our prophet said so. That's enough for me, because our prophet said so. We honor him. We honor the first Supreme Grand Sheik within the Moorish Scientific of America, St. Edward Milieu, to our present-day patriarch, our Sheik of Islam, Sheikh Ra Saadi El. We give honors to all friends, sympathizers, all those who embrace this beautiful concept of Islam, who live it, who eat it, who drink it, who bathe in it every day, we want to extend to you in the Moorish American greeting to and from and saying, Islam, Islam, Islam. I'm Grand Governess Yssis Saadi L, and we are Grand Temple number 2. This is our Friday HolyDay service. And we want to extend honors to all those who have definitely embraced this day as being a blessed holy day. And often enough, people had questioned us in our measures of saying blessed. Why would you be offended or feel some way about us saying blessed and staying happy? Seems like blessed has a greater degree for me than happy, because there's nothing negative, nothing obscure, nothing that's a disadvantage or will be made to look that is not touched by Allah when you place blessed in front of it. But happy? Oh, you got people. Happy at the strip club, happy at happy hour, happy doing noise. Or you can be happy in your wrong. Mm. Or you can be happy doing everything under the sun that's wrong, and you know it. Happy is an emotion that has no attachment to morality, that has no attachment to divinity. Happy is just an emotion. People are happy drunks. People get happy when they smoke weed. They get real happy and hungry. So you can be happy doing a whole bunch of naught. A whole bunch of naught. But when you bless it, it comes with a responsibility. It comes with attachment of divinity. It comes with accountability. It comes with knowing that Allah is watching, even when no one else is. You put blessing in front of it? Oh, you done raised it up. You done changed the whole status of it now. So we extend a blessed holy day to you, because it is our measure here as being styled as the temples of Islam to exemplify a heightened degree of what we say, how we say it, what we do, how we do it, to reflect our faith of Islam to the utmost, to the utmost. Not fear of losing friends, fame, or fortune, because we know Allah got this. We know Allah got this. It is not what we go through, but how we go through it. I want to give my measure, and then I'm going to turn it over to our chief of ministers. We're going to demonstrate from our Circle 7 Quran, divinely prepared by our prophet, Nabiju Ali, by the God of his father, God Allah, the great God of the universe, to redeem men from his fallen state of humanity back to the highest spring of life and being one again. Our Father, God Allah. We're going to go to excuse me, everyone, I apologize. I had my thought going on and it's on. Okay, we got it. Chapter 9. Jesus attended the fest at Behar, and here he taught human equality. I'm going to, I think it's one of the longest chapters, but I'm not going to read the whole chapter. Y'all have the Circle 7 Quran. You can read it at your leisure. You should at least be familiar with this Quran. So I'm just going to bring out a couple of things. Now, what has happened that Jesus has himself around the priest. And Jesus decided to be around the Khatijah. I'm going to go where 11. These courtesans and thieves are children of my father Allah. They souls are just as precious in the sight as yours or of the Barmetic priests. And we are working out our sums of life, the life sums that you have saw. You men look at them with scorn. I'm gonna jump down to 14. They are sinners and they confess their guilt while you are guilty but are shrewd enough to have polished coats to cover up your guilt. Suppose you men who scorn the courtesans, these drunkards and these thieves, who know that you are pure in heart and life, that you are better, far than they. Stand forth, that men may know just who you are. It's one of the beautiful lessons my chief minister gave, and it's a demonstration that we did on the radio show. And we actually did it as a series, and you can actually Google it. It's on Spotify. They actually Google Chief. They got him as a music artist. It's called Slave to Sin. And one of the lessons I remember when we was doing we was going to our federal prisons, he was speaking with the brothers, and many of them, they was young. They just was heavy-hearted by, you know, life itself, the decisions that they made. And she said, don't allow your, and I'm paraphrasing, don't allow your presence in this prison to define you. Don't allow yourself to be a slave to sin. Release yourself from that. You gotta forgive yourself. And once you step across the threshold into Islam and you say that there is no Allah but Allah and that the Prophet is a prophet, Prophet said, I forgive you for everything you did. Now you come with a responsibility to uphold the law, to live a righteous moral life. And once you have made that measure, don't allow anyone to rob or take that away from you. How dare someone place scorn upon someone who went through stuff? It's one of the things I remember as a Christian, doing a, not me, I wasn't a good Christian, I was one of those seasonal church goers before I got into Islam. I think many of us was at a certain point, but I remember hearing folks in church say that to dictate your faith, because they ain't God. Don't allow people to hold you a slave to your past transgressions. Because often enough, if whoever is standing up here at the podium, at the rostrum, or on a soapbox or a milk crate, they should have been through something in order to bring people forth to say, and look at me, the possibility of man. The possibility that I went through this and I can tell you I overcome. I did a measurement and I used my teacher as an example. As a child, he almost drowned because he disobeyed his mom. But even through his struggle, he was saved by the lifeguard and turned that stumbling block into a stepping stone, took up swimming lessons, and became the number one mate of a pool. I mean, the number one, and saved several lives during his tenure as a lifeguard. People know his history because he ain't let no one allow him to put them in, to make them, make him a slave to his sin. He spoke about it. You wouldn't have known he was on crack or that he was a pimp and a drug dealer. You wouldn't have known that. One of the beautiful things and one of the lessons, I was like, wait, hell, Malcolm X was a drug dealer, a drug user. He was a pimp. But it was in prison where he met Allah, where he was introduced to his faith. And through his own trials and tribulations and struggles, he was able to raise men and women across the country out of the muck and getting clean. because he was an example of them to say, hell, he did it, perhaps I can do it too. Our chief minister shared stories among stories, and I remember being in the prison, he shared stories with the brothers and how he, you know, was on crack and how he was out there in San Francisco and Oakland and you know, the things that he had to go through and the things he witnessed. But he made it in himself because Allah was guiding him when he didn't even know it. When he heard the voice, get right, stay right now, I'll be with you. That was a motivational factor for him to get right and then allow his own struggles and then became into success stories to where others can say, hell, he did it. I was with him. I saw him. I used to buy the lighter. I used to sit next to him, get high. But hell, he got clean. And when others saw him get clean, it inspired them to get clean. And all the brothers that was in that crew of Moors all went through the drug program. And many of them became drug counselors. You don't tell me that ain't Allah? That ain't God? And you got certain folks that's claiming to be Moorish American Muslims, divine ministers, this, that, and the other. That's saying that brothers and sisters that been in worse conditions in life, that they are not worthy of Islam. They're not worthy of leadership. They are not worthy to be looked upon as Muslims. And it's you people that hold that idea up. You is just as guilty as they are. The fact that you embrace that person, you embrace that idea, you is just as guilty. You is just as dirty, you is just as evil and ugly of a spirit as they are. I'm calling it for what it is. I seen and I bear witness to Allah, brothers coming up to my, I was in awe. We in the federal prison, a big old prison. And it was during our Prophet's Day celebration, and the brothers was all over the chief. I'm sitting there just like trying to be cordial or whatever. I'm like, this is interesting. And they all over him like they breaking out the yearbooks. But they just wanted to hear his measure because they know where he been. They heard the tapes. They see, they read his books. They know his bio. How did you get through this, brother? How? Tell me how. Can you share with me your story? Can you share with me your struggle so I can use it? Maybe I need it. And then I remember it was a brother from the Nation of Islam stepped to the chief and said, I want a wife like you. I want a life like you. I bear witness before Allah. When someone has been through something, let me tell you something. My Quran gives witness to that. It says, He must suffer trials and temptations manifold, but let him know that the cherubim and the seraphim that ruled the stations of the Son of the Spirit of the Mighty Allah, who ruled the solar stars, are his protectors and his guide, and they will lead to victory. Man will be fully saved, redeemed by and perfected by the things he suffer on the plane of flesh. Again, man will be fully saved, redeemed, perfected by the things he suffers on the plane of flesh and on the planes of soul. And when man has conquered carnal things, Islam, when man has conquered carnal things, his garb of flesh will then have served its purpose well, and it will fall, will be no more. Will be no more. You can't tell me the things that you ain't suffered and you ain't gone through. And you hear? And those that say or turn their nose up and speak ill of those that been through something? My prophet been through something. All the prophets of Allah been through something. My prophet was imprisoned. They put my prophet in prison. Is he not worthy? How dare you, and how dare you Moors hold up to someone who speaks that idea, who brings that measure in the forefront of the public? You hold it up, you're guilty. You're as evil and despicable as everyone else. And the fact that you don't speak on it or point it out, you're as guilty as he is. You are nodding to the north. You agreeing to the foolishness because you ain't saying nothing in the public. One thing, when someone says something in the public, you check them in the public. You don't check them in private. Because you let everybody know he wrong. You check them in the public. When my daughter was 5 years old, she decided she wanted to take candy from a gas station. We lived in Gwinnett County. My oldest daughter said, "Mommy, I be got candy." I said, "How the hell I be get candy? Where she get candy from?" "I don't know." "Yeah, you do know." "Yeah, you do know."
Sniffing.
So, I'm looking at my daughter, pull out the pockets, a couple of annihilators and one of them other little candies. "Where you get this from? And don't you dare lie." And she pointed to the store. I took her to the store. I told the gentleman, I put it up there. I said, "Excuse me, sir, my daughter had confiscated a couple of these items for you. What do you want to do with her?" And he was just looking at me. I said, "What do you want to do with her? Because by law, thieves go to jail." He said, "No, ma'am, I don't want no trouble. I don't want no trouble." I gave the man the money for the candy. I don't know how much she stole because she ate most of it. I gave her enough to cover. She couldn't get that much. Couldn't took that much. $5 or whatever. I said, "Put the candy in your pocket." She didn't want to put the candy in. I said, "Put the candy in your pocket. You're going to eat every piece of it. You're going to eat your guilt. You're going to remember this moment." I checked my child in the public because I didn't want her to know that that was okay. By me whispering in the secret, by me taking her home and chastising her and spanking her and not letting others know that, I checked my children in the public. Leaders and heads of temples, you ain't checking your members when they wrong? You a punk, you a coward, I'll tell you that to your face. You a punk and you a coward. And the fact that you allow it to go on in the public shows that your degree of the embodiment of the evil, of the cesspool that has been driven into the temples and the marginalization of Islam and our prophet, is being overran by people like you. I love my chief minister. He's my leader, he's my teacher, and then he's my husband.